Michael is a very inspirational speaker. He managed in a very short speech of just over half an hour to relate fully to the concerns that our company has about the future. So his speech was short and to the point.
In our 2012 staff conference, we had the pleasure of hosting Michael Virardi, who gave us a very inspirational speech on how we can come across the challenges that we all face in the difficult environment. I would recommend Michael to any company to make a speech to make the difference.
Good morning, Abacus. And congratulations. I have seen your creations, and you're great. You must have had a full weekend. Before I congratulate and thank you, I would like to say a few thank yous on my own. I would like to say thank you to two particular people who have helped me tremendously in structuring this speech, and I believe are also responsible for organizing this lovely event. That is Theodoros Vertis and Stella Rododou. A warm hand of applause. Thank you. I would also like to say thank you to Mr. Nikolaidis, who has recently read my latest book, called me in his office, and has given me the chance, the opportunity, and the honor to be presenting here today to his team. Thank you very much, Mr. Nikolaidis. I would like to thank also my father, who is joining me here today. He's not only my father, he's my best friend and also my mentor. Thank you. He has heard me speak quite a few times. I believe he came here for the Platteris excursion to enjoy the weather. I'm sure about that. And last but not least, I would like to thank and congratulate all of you. I would like to thank and congratulate all of you for the same reason, because I have recently completed a survey of 101 successful people. I have been all over the hierarchy, across the ranks, from CEOs, managers, supervisors, all the way to secretaries and cleaning ladies, and I have asked them what constitutes success. And many things came afloat, but there is one thing that came up first with 92%, and that is that successful people like yourselves show up in conferences like these ones, events or seminars, because they know something that less successful people, or I dare say unsuccessful people, do not know. They show up because they understand that one new acquaintance or one new idea can revolutionize your personal and professional lives. One new acquaintance, as the saying goes, your network will determine your net worth at the end of the day. And as a fellow lecturer of mine says, when it comes to ideas, if I have 1 euro and you have 1 euro and we exchange it, we both end up having 1 euro. But if I have one idea and you have one idea and we exchange it, we both end up having 2 ideas each. And the main purpose, I believe, of this conference, of this 2-day conference, is the exchange of ideas. And with this in mind, I would also like to congratulate you, because it's your ideas that have helped you be nominated for the In Business Awards 2012 in the service category. Well done to all of you. Both my wife, Christine, and myself have casted our vote electronically for Abacus. And I will be there at the night of the event and hope we win it. Well done. Excellent. So our title for today is The Circle of Trust. Unlike many speeches you heard in the past, during this speech, I will not analyze the title at the beginning. I will let the title flow. And hopefully, by the end of this presentation, each and every person in this room will totally understand what we mean by the circle of trust. One thing I promise you is that I will follow my father's advice when it comes to public speaking. He once told me that a speech should be like a miniskirt. It should be short enough in order to be attractive and long enough in order to cover the essential parts. So with this in mind, let's proceed to a short test that each and every person in this room will take it on its own. And please do not shout the answer out. Just keep it between your 2 ears. Here's the test. I would like you to count how many Fs you see in this passage. How many times the letter F appears in this passage? You have 30 seconds. Oh, don't shout it out. Don't shout it out. Please raise your hands for those of you who found 3 Fs. Okay, thank you. Four Fs. Raise your hand if you found five Fs. And raise your hand if you found six Fs. Go search for six Fs. Search for six Fs. Search for six Fs. Help your colleagues. Six Fs? Raise your hand if you found six Fs now. Raise your hand, six, excellent. Six Fs? Excellent. What is the purpose of this short exercise? An F can be an F for going forward, or an F can be an F for fail. Our world of ours today is on fire. And we do not have the luxury, we do not have the luxury to miss any Fs like we used to have in the past. If we zoom into Cyprus and then move out, we will see that in Cyprus, 16.2% of our fellow Cypriots are living for the first time ever under the poverty line. 24.7% of the young adults under the age of 25 are unemployed. There are over 45,000 registered unemployed, and there is an equal number of non-registered unemployed in this country. According to a prominent newspaper, Philelefteros, 90 to 110 small to medium businesses close every month. And in the next 2 years, according to the same newspaper, 60,000 small to medium enterprises are under the threat of going bust. If we move a bit further out, if we go to Greece, there are 1 million people that are registered unemployed. And this number is going up by the second. And there are 200 million world citizens that are unemployed. You multiply that 200 million by five, which is the average number in a household that are influenced, and you get 1 billion out of the 7 billion who inhabit this earth that have limited income or no income. In the last year, 9 more euro economies have been downgraded. And as we have all witnessed, economies like the Cyprus economy, Greece economy, Ireland, Spain, Italy, Portugal, are under the threat of going under Troika and EU monitoring, or have already been under Troika and EU monitoring. So the question now, my friends, becomes, what do we do? Where do we go from here? In my research, I have seen two people that have answered this question very successfully. One of them is Dr. Albert Einstein, when he defined insanity. And he said that insanity is continue doing what we've done yesterday and expecting today to have a different result. Continue doing what we've done as Abacus in 2001 until 2011 or 12 and expecting to have a different result in 2013 and 2014 under the same economic conditions. And it is not a coincidence that the same lecturer, Dr. Albert Einstein, gave the same test twice in a row as a final exam to his students. And one of the young students, a young girl, went up to him and he said, Dr. Einstein, you must be mistaken. You gave the same final exams 2 years in a row. He laughed, he smiled, and he said, oh, the questions are the same, but the answers have changed. And the questions, my dear friends, are exactly the same. How do I increase my turnover? How do I decrease my costs? How do I increase my profitability? How do I decrease my mistakes? How do I differentiate from my competitors and become more efficient? But the answers in today's world environment have changed. And one person who knows this is a gentleman you see now on your screen. For those of you who don't know him, his name is Howard Schultz, and he's the owner and major shareholder of Starbucks. I read his autobiography recently, and he said something that really resonated with me. He said that we are not in the coffee business serving people. We are in the people business serving coffee. And the same holds true for us, my dear friends. We are not in the global services serving people. We're in the people business, happening to serve our fiduciary services, our tax services, and our global services in general. The people or the organizations who have not grasped that we're in the people business have only but to lose. And one organization that has really grasped this, and I mentioned this organization in my latest book, is Zappos. For all of you who don't know Zappos, let me tell you who this company is. Very recently, we heard some very shocking news. We heard that Amazon bought Zappos. Zappos trades on the World Wide Web. They have a nice website. They import shoes of different brands, and they have a warehouse, a big warehouse, and approximately 200 people as employees. And Amazon recently bought them. Get ready to hear the amount that Amazon and its owner, Jeff Bezos, have paid for Zappos. 1.2, not million, but $1.2 billion. And when Jeff Bezos, the CEO of Amazon, was asked, how come you paid so much money? You could have easily imitated their website and done it better. You have the logistics, you have the know-how. Easily imported shoes, bought a bigger warehouse, and killed them off. And he said, we could have easily done all of these things you're saying, but there is one thing we could have never imitated, and that is the relationships they have managed to build with their customers and their suppliers. And that is what we bought. And just to let you know in on Amazon, Tony Hsieh is a former owner, and he wrote an excellent book titled Delivering Happiness. And in this book, which is his autobiography, he mentions how they wow customers and how they build their customer loyalty. First of all, you can buy a shoe from Zappos, free freight, they ship it to you, and you can return it back, not in one day, not in one week, not in one month, after 364 days if you don't want it. Free shipment goes back. To graduate from the Zappos Academy, you have to go through an intensive 4 weeks course, mainly answering telephones. Once you graduate, on the day of the graduation, Tony Hsieh comes onto the stage, the owner, and you have to recite in front of him the company's 10 core values. And once you do that as well, he gets up and he says, anyone who wants to leave now out that door will be given a $2,000 bonus, plus their monthly payment for staying for 4 weeks at the academy. And when he's asked by reporters, but why do you give so much money out to at least 1% who walk out? Because he says that's just a small amount of money to pay for people who are only money oriented and they don't care about my customers, the loyalty we've built with our customers. And reading through his book, I found something that I strongly believe it is interesting for you to have a look at. And these are the courses offered by Zappos to anyone who wants to go up the ranks from the telephone operator all the way to supervisor, manager, and then CEO. And when you look at the courses, which I'm going to show you now, please have a look if you see anywhere in there the word sales or selling. You won't, because he strongly believes in building trust. Sales will come on their own. And here are the courses they are offering. 4 weeks hiring training. 4 weeks to train mainly on the phones, answering phones. Zappos history and Zappos culture. It's very important to understand where the company came from and where the company is going. Communication 1, 2, and 3. People should be able to communicate. They have two lovely books. One of them is The Fred Factor. I strongly urge you to read this book. It's a fantastic book. They have Intro to Finance, Science of Happiness, and Leadership. And they continue with the second list, which is Human Resources. They take courses in human resources management. Another book, which is Made to Stick. Again, finance. Public speaking. People should be able to express themselves. Delivering Happiness again. Knowledge in computers, Apple or Microsoft. Grammar and writing. Stress management, time management. Wowing through tours. Anyone can go to Las Vegas and book their tour and go on a tour to visit the Zappos family, as they call it. So they even have a roadmap when they tour their offices. Customer loyalty, so they can maintain the customer loyalty. And last but not least, progression plan workshop, so you can progress in the company, so you can move on. And this is a company that has really grasped it in the people business. And in the people business, my dear friends, we need to differentiate on two levels. One, as an individual, and secondly, as a company. So how do we differentiate as an individual? Very recently, the survey of IBM came out. IBM survey came out. IBM as IBM in computers. They have a lovely survey. They go around the globe asking 1,700 CEOs like Mr. Nikolaidis what the future entails for businesses. What is the successful model that a business should follow in order to succeed? And what kind of employees do we need to employ in this new model? Two of the questions asked were, what differentiated individuals would you like in your organization? How should they be? And the second question was, what should we send our children to study so when they come back in five years' time, your organization will be able to absorb them? Answering the second question, all CEOs said, we do not know what you should send your children to study because the world is changing so fast. And we do not only mean in technological terms, but we also mean in people's wants and needs. But we do know something. We do know what kind of employee we want in our organization. And this is the kind of employee they want in their organization. The four major traits. Number one, that employee should be collaborative. That employee should be able to work in a team because no one is smarter than all of us together. They need to be able to work in a team so to service the Abacus customer more promptly and more professionally. Recently, I was giving a whole day seminar for one of the best companies on the island called ECA. And ECA, they are now into office furniture. And they've been abroad to an exhibition. And for the first time, they've seen exhibitors showing the new collaborative offices where people come together to service the most intelligent and the most informative customer of all times. So number one, with 75%, is that we need our employees, our team, to be collaborative, to be able to work in a team. Secondly, they need to be communicative. And by communicative, I don't only mean to be able to speak, but to be able to use their two ears and one mouth in the same proportion that God has given it to them. Listen twice and talk once. Because if you listen twice, you'll be able to understand your customers' needs and wants, and you will be able, as Abacus, to match them with your service. But you should also, like the Zappos example, be able to communicate. That's why they offer three courses in communication, and be able to be a good public speaker. It's not what you say, it's how you say it. In third and fourth position, with 60%, is to be creative. And by creative, the CEOs mean step out of your box. Look at the new answers to the old questions. Become creative. And you have been creative the last day or so, and maybe more. But we need to step out of our box. We need to look at the new answers to the same old questions. And last, fourth trait, be flexible. And by flexible, they mean flexible in learning. Be a fast learner. Understand the new technologies. Understand your customers' wants and needs, and be mobile as well, inflexible. Today you might be in Limassol, tomorrow you might be in London, the next day you might be in Lisbon. The new differentiated employee has to have these four major traits according to the IBM case study that came out. And the question now is, how do we differentiate as Abacus? How do we differentiate as a company? Very recently, I saw a very nice advertisement of your company that I loved. So I scanned it and I put it on the wall. And here is your advertisement. Let me read it aloud. Because only a thin line separates success from failure. Great companies from ordinary ones. Make the call. With only 17 words, in my opinion, you have managed to grasp the new answers. Make the call, and you have managed to associate tennis with business. So you have given me an inspiration, and I have come up with three pillars of how you can differentiate as a company by associating tennis with business. Are we ready? Pillar number one, a good first serve. In tennis, if you have a good, strong first serve, your chances of winning that point are 65 to 75%. And I believe if you win that point, you have a better chance of winning that game, that set, and ultimately the match. And the same holds true in business, my dear friends. We need to have a good, strong first service. According to psychologists, the first 7 to 30 seconds in any encounter with any customer anywhere in the world, either on the phone or tete-a-tete, in the first 7 to 30 seconds, they're very crucial. In the first 7 seconds, your client, our client, makes subconscious decisions whether to work with us or not. Within 30 seconds, that same client knows on a conscious level whether to work with Abacus or not. And Walt Disney knows this very well. Because if you ever go to Walt Disney with your kids and you ask them, excuse me, what time does the park close? The answer is, the park is open until 8. Not the park closes at 8. The park is open until 8. It's not what you say. It's how you say it that matters. In my book, Positive Impact, which also features on Amazon, I bring the example of somebody calling the theater. And they are calling the theater. Let me illustrate this for you. It's a Monday. Theater ABC, this is Mary speaking. How may I help you? Hi, we would like 2 tickets for the theater, please. Unfortunately, we have no tickets. We have tickets only for Friday's performance. Let's go back and see it in a positive vein. Theater ABC, this is Mary speaking. How may I help you? Again, it's a Monday, and again, no tickets. Yes, we would like 2 tickets for the performance, please. You are in luck. We have 2 tickets for Friday's 2nd performance, 4th seat. Excellent viewing. Would you like me to reserve those? It's not what you say. It's how you say it. From the moment your customers or your clients hear the word, unfortunately, they start thinking of Abacus as competitors. And to illustrate this point and to finish on the first pillar, I thought wise of showing you a video that I have stumbled across. It's a very short video, 1.5 minutes long, that I believe gives us the true meaning of it's not what you say, but it's how you say it. Are we ready to watch it?
Do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
It's a beautiful day, and I cannot see it. I leave the assumptions up to you. And with this powerful video, we move on to the second pillar of company differentiation, which comes from Andre Agassi's, the ex-world star player in tennis, autobiography, The Open. In his autobiography, Andre Agassi said something remarkable. He said, what separates the good players from the great players is not the game set, but rather the mindset. What separates the good players from the great players, it's not the game set, but rather the mindset. And reading into your website, I have seen that you mentioned that you are a world-class company dealing with world-class customers, clients. And to be able to do that, and you mention it, you have world-class people working for you, which are passionate and are also have the same purpose. So these passionate and purposeful employees, they have one thing in common. They have the right mindset. Because when most companies now are focused on the game set because of the economic conditions, they lose their mindset. They forget to invest in their mindset. And what you have done today and yesterday with this retreat, and well done to the management team who have organized it, is that they are working on your mindset, because your mindset at the end of the day will perfect your game set. So well done for that. And this second pillar leads us to the third pillar. So first is a very good serve, preserving our mindset, and it leads us to the third pillar of company differentiation. Very recently, I attended a speech by a very prominent lawyer and a good friend, George Zetiorgiou, who's very good on labor law. He spoke at the Amethyst Hotel in Limassol, where my wife, Christine, is a coordinator. And whilst he was speaking and explaining labor law, he brought an example. He said, whilst watching the US Open, he noticed just before the finals, there were two umpires at the end of the court, not three, two linesmen instead of three. And he noticed that one of the linesmen, when the first serve was coming in, he was sticking his leg out and his head like a curious ostrich to see if the serve is in or out, and then moving back to his base, to his line. And I think there is an association here with businesses. In your case, in Abacus, there were no redundancies to my knowledge. But in most companies, there were redundancies all across the globe. So people now need to do more things than they used to do in the past. They need to cover more lines. They need to come back to the baseline and have a better viewing. In your case, you are giving it 100%, but we need to give it 110% as we are servicing the most intellectual and informative customer of all times. As the competition is becoming more fierce, we need to go back to the baseline. John F. Kennedy said it best 55 years ago when he said, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. And now is the time to paraphrase John F. Kennedy and say, ask not what your company can do for you, ask what you can do for your company in this day and age. So my dear friends, in closing, I would like to press rewind and go back to our title, The Circle of Trust. I strongly believe that up to now, most of you, if not all of you, have understood the circle of trust. On an individual level, we need to be team players. We need to be able to communicate, first by using our two ears and one mouth, and then by being able to say things in the way that they should be said. We need to be creative, think outside the box, and flexible with our internal customers and our external customers. As a company, it's imperative to differentiate by having a good first serve, by preserving our mindset, which will ultimately win our game set. And last but not least, we need to move back to the baseline, go back to basics, do more than is expected of us. So in closing, I would like to say that trust, in my opinion, starts from the heart. The heart is closer to the pocket than the brain is. So if you win your customer's heart, you are closer to their pocket than if you win their brains. People buy emotionally and they justify logically. So I would like to show the circle of trust and then give you a small wallet size gift to carry with you forever. And this is a circle of trust. It starts with a strong team. If there is a strong Abacus team, then you get nominated for the In Business Awards. Then you show growth. Then you have a better profitability. If there is a strong team and moving clockwise, we move to the individual. One individual can show indifference and lead the company astray from its goals, or one individual can show commitment and the 110% and move the company towards its goals. That individual should have an attitude of gratitude. The sea will not change. We have to learn to navigate the sea. And if that individual shows an attitude of gratitude and is giving on a daily basis that little extra, he or she becomes extraordinary. And what is an extraordinary person? An extraordinary person is merely an ordinary person doing the little extra on a daily basis. If you do that, then we come to relationships. And what is a relationship? All relationships, be it the young boy who flirts with the young girl, be it the banker who wants to get the customer to deposit the money in the bank, be it Abacus who wants to approach a new customer, everything starts with high tension and low trust. Our aim is to reverse this analogy. Decrease the tension and increase the trust. We do that by being prompt. We do that by being professional. We do that by being passionate. We do that by delivering more than expected the day before it's due. And once you do that, you come to the last circle, which is trust. You cement it with trust. And if this circle is completed correctly, we are not 150 people at Abacus. We are 151 because the customer comes on board, and then 152, and then 153. And he joined us in a word of mouth. So to conclude, I would like once again to paraphrase John F. Kennedy, ask not what your company can do for you, ask what you can do for your company. Thank you very much.